Why is desalination so hard? I mean, don't get me wrong, we desalinate water all around the world today, but it requires huge amounts of investment and a ton of energy. Adding salt to water is as simple as dropping it in and giving it a stir. But to get that salt back out is a lot more difficult. Ironically, the bonds that hold the salt crystals together are stronger than the bonds that hold the salt to the water. So why exactly is that? And how does this all work? And what new breakthroughs in the world of desalination can finally solve our fresh water shortages? Let's figure this out together. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Adventure. This video is brought to you by EcoFlow, but more on that later. So this is our solar desalination setup. So as you can see, we kind of built something with a little bit of an angle with this glass on top, and you can see that the dew actually is forming. What's really interesting is we did a time lapse to see this in action, and we realized we haven't sealed the box well enough, because actually as the water vaporizes, it builds up pressure inside and it'll push out into the lower pressure area out here. So there's probably some leakage points, and I'm seeing that our tape job isn't perfect, but you can see this is all pure clean water from the salt inside that we hope will condense and run down into our collection chamber. You'd think desalination was hard because it's hard to break the bond between water and salt, right? Well, I thought that too, but turns out I was wrong. In fact, when I started studying the process, I found that it's actually the opposite. To understand what happens when you try to pry water and salt apart, let's start with what happens when you dissolve salt in water. Dissolving salt requires disintegrating the little crystals, making room in water for the salt to dissolve, and then actually dissolving it. From a chemical perspective, this process involves breaking strong ionic bonds within the salt crystal lattice to break down the crystals, and hydrogen bonds in the water to make room for the ions, which both require input energy. Then it involves forming new ion-dipole interactions when water molecules surround and separate each ion, something called hydration, which releases energy. These ion-dipole interactions are the force that sticks salt and water together. Now here's the thing, ion-ion interactions like those between sodium and chloride in salt crystals are some of the strongest types of interactions known in chemistry. The second strongest are the ion-dipole interactions between salt and water. So that means that it's harder to break apart ions in salt than it is to separate ions from water. So if it was only about the energy in bonds, it should be easier to desalinate water than to dissolve salt in the water in the first place. This surprised me, and it's a little counterintuitive, but luckily, it all starts making sense when you think about thermodynamics, because it turns out I was only looking at half the picture. According to the second law of thermodynamics, we need to factor in entropy, or the measure of how disordered a system is. The natural tendency is for entropy, or disorder, to increase. Build a house, a highly ordered and organized structure, and abandon it for 1,000 years, and it'll return to a disorganized pile of rocks and soil. So the next time someone tells you your room or your car is dirty, just blame entropy. We're trying to take dissolved ions that are running around freely in water like a bunch of crazy kindergartners and stick them together to form a perfectly ordered crystal lattice. So to desalinate water means we have to fight against nature and put things into higher ordered states. So even though from a chemical perspective, salt would rather be in a crystal than dissolved in water, from a thermodynamic perspective, the desalination process faces an uphill battle against entropy, which is thermodynamically unfavorable. So in essence, whatever innovative technology we come up with, desalination will always require a significant energy input to overcome the entropic barrier. Now, we did build this system to be able to do it three different ways. So now let's go take it over and try our hand at some thermal desalination. Early desalination technology relied on thermal desalination like this test setup here. We have an induction cooktop as our heat source, and the sealed chamber should condense water on the glass. And gravity should feed it all into our collection chamber.
Wow, on high it uses about 1700 watts of power. That's interesting.
So while this is cooking, let me tell you about how we're powering all of this with our sponsor this week, EcoFlow, and this, their brand new Delta Pro 3. The total capacity in this thing has increased to 4 kilowatt hours and has a maximum AC output of 4,000 watts. That's enough to power almost everything from miter saws to window ACs, fridges, and much more. Plus, my favorite part about the new Delta Pro 3s is that it has two solar inputs. The high voltage PV port handles 30 to 150 volts with a maximum of 1600 watts, while the low voltage PV port handles 11 to 60 volts and 1000 watts. So we actually have three solar panels connected in series going into the high voltage port and one panel going into the low voltage. And all combined, we're producing about 1,000 watts, but we could produce more if we had more solar panels. Beyond this awesome new design, it still retains the great rolling wheels and pullout handle to make it easy to move around. And it has a ton of ports, like 4 20-amp 120 outlets, 1 240-volt outlet, and even has a NEMA L1430 30-amp outlet, plus a bunch of DC, like 2 100-watt USB-C charging ports and 2 USB-A ports, and much more. It can also tie into our smart home panel too in our office with a single cable and help power the office when we're home. It's a killer combination of stationary storage when you're home and power on the go. Register now on EcoFlow's official website to stay tuned for their upcoming EcoFlow Delta Pro 3 launch live stream and receive benefits worth up to $3,000 at 7 o'clock Pacific time on June 24th. Links in the description. Huge thanks to EcoFlow and you. Now back to the show. Now, induction cooktops are really efficient, but if we really wanted to make this setup better, we could use a heat pump for heating the water. By doing so, we could produce between 3 to 5 times as much heat per unit of energy. Plus, with the cold side of that heat pump, we could better condense the water out of the air. But the good news is this battery actually can take solar power, so we can actually power this from the sun. Let's do that.
Yep, that is the high, so that's good. And this is the low.
Cool. All right.
Solar coming in, batteries running.
Water's warming up. Let's get the glass back on.
So prior to the 1980s, over 84% of all desalination worldwide happened with thermal desalination. But there are some challenges with thermal desalination. For one thing, water has a very high latent heat of evaporation. That is the amount of energy required to turn liquid water into a gas. This stubbornness is hugely valuable for water as it becomes a great temperature buffer and it's very stable, making it a wonderful thing here on Earth, but it also means boiling it takes that much more energy.
Yeah. Okay. All right, so we're gonna stop here. The induction cooktop has an overheat protection, so it's turning off, but you can see this very crude system. This water here is clean.
So we were blowing with a leaf blower to cool the top glass because what needs to happen is there needs to be a cold surface for the water to condense on. And this glass is also pretty warm. So let's go ahead and take this thing apart. Woo, it is warm. Look at all that steam. And if I kind of help it along, you can kind of see, look at that. And it's going into the collection reservoir. Oh, that's cool. Look at that. That is fresh water right there. But it shows you our design flaw was having a cold surface, cold enough for it to collect on. But look at that. That's all fresh water. Fresh water. And there is the results of our labor. Some fresh water here and the original salt water there. But we're not done.
Another approach to desalination is solar desalination, mimicking the water cycle here on Earth powered by the sun. Now, because we were running our EcoFlow Delta Pro 3s on solar, that meant that that previous setup was technically solar powered as well, but a traditional setup would use the heat from the sun directly.
If we left it for a few more hours, we could probably collect a little more, but we did get some water. Look at this, come in here, Juan, if you can see that, but look at this. Salt water, fresh water, not a lot. We didn't run it for very long. It wasn't a perfect system. But as you can see, there's fresh water down there. There's all the dew on the glass, so you can kind of see if I just help it along a little, it'll start to trickle down. And that's what we were hoping would do is collect.
But let's call this a success, I think. We're not commercializing this just yet, gentlemen. I think we got a little bit of work to do.
But if we scale this system up, maximized heat and sun collection, we could desalinate water in a very simple way for free each and every day directly from sunshine. Sound off in the comments below if you want us to make a full video about this because there are some exciting new projects that are happening around the world that use this very technology. The general design though pretty much stays the same. Allow in light, trap the heat, force water to evaporate, but let that steam condense on the glass and run down into a collection reservoir. But one of the drawbacks with systems like this is that all the leftover particulate, like the salt, would be left behind and require cleanup. But that isn't a problem for the most popular form of desalination technology around the world, reverse osmosis desalination, which passively removes salt and other impurities from water by forcing it through a very fine membrane. Here, salty water is forced through an extremely fine membrane that separates the water from the salt and other impurities, like pouring your pasta into a fine mesh sieve to let it drain but at a microscopic level. The process is cheaper and more efficient, and advances in membrane technology lead to longer lifetimes and less maintenance. But the big drawback for the reverse osmosis system is the need for very high pressures to make the process work efficiently. A reverse osmosis facility in Kuwait, for example, expends more than 889 gigawatt hours of energy annually to purify their water. And most of that energy comes from pumping.
One really final thing. I've been really curious about this. This is an ultrasonic humidifier, right? It basically moves a little speaker at such a high frequency that it causes a low pressure section when it goes up and down, and it causes the water to evaporate out. All right, so that used almost no energy, but you can see there's a fair bit of steam in there. I'm curious if it's actually gonna be salty or not. Let's test that out. It's not really evaporating the water, so like the salt molecules could be pushed and along with it. We'll see, let's find out. First of all, the glass is cold, unlike before, because there was so much heat being put in, like 1,000 watts of heat in a box with no insulation or ventilation. But now it should be, woo, you see that? And it's a little bit salty. Is that interesting? So this was what I thought would happen, because I figured I'm not the first person to have this idea of using ultrasonic to vaporize water and to desalinate that way. Because when you evaporate the water, you force the water molecules, which evaporate at 100 degrees Celsius, to evaporate, and the salt gets left behind. But this kind of forces the water to vaporize and take some salt with it. Pretty cool.
The big thing with desalination is that it requires energy. Ultimately, that's gonna always be the case because of the laws of thermodynamics we mentioned before that were fighting entropy. We've had one of the rainiest winters here in San Diego that I can recall, and I was so angered by a story that I read that our dams here were filling up to such high levels, and they're so old and beyond repair that they were letting out the water to prevent the dam from collapsing, which means that we just don't seem to learn our lesson. The rate of water flow can vary, but we do get rain in most parts around the world. I was just in Panama, they're in a drought, but the rains are gonna come back, and when they do, they're gonna have a lot. So the goal ultimately is to have a buffer tank. It's like that EcoFlow battery. If you have solar input all day, and then whatever you use overnight can be replenished the next day when the sun comes back out, you're fine. Maybe we don't need to desalinate water every single day. All we have to do is keep our reservoirs full. So for example, in California, there's a phenomenon where at high noon on really sunny days, there's so much solar generation that we have to curtail it or waste it because there's just nowhere for it to go. Imagine if we had desalination plants on the ready to jump in and use excess energy, or to run at times where there's low demand to produce fresh water. And then on some cloudy days, let it rest, and maybe the reservoir level goes down a little, but eventually we'll fill them back. And that's the beautiful thing about solar and batteries. It's the same thing with water desalination and a reservoir. As long as we keep the reservoirs full, this could work. So ultimately, yes, desalination is hard, but it is so critical because it can allow us to fill in drought periods when there's not enough rainfall to continue the cycle. But one of the most fascinating things I learned recently was about the photomolecular effect, how MIT scientists recently discovered new ways of how photons from the sun evaporate water, and it wasn't from heat like we all thought. And if you're curious what that could mean for the future desalination, check out this video next.